Violence still rages in Kenya, despite a recent peace deal. Burned out of their homes, multitudes of refugees languish in camps, too scared to go back to their farms. In forest hideouts, militia gangs are mobilizing for fresh attacks.
They are going to fight up to the last man, and they are ready to fight, and they are ready to die.
At the root of the crisis, too many people chasing too few jobs and too little land.
This is a scene I never thought I'd witness in Kenya, a country that has been described as a stable democracy in Africa.
We headed for Western Kenya. There'd been chaos here after failed elections last year. We wanted to see if things had improved since the peace deal. But as soon as we got to the slopes of Mount Elgon, we got word of a brutal militia attack.
Last night at 2 a.m, about 30 attackers armed with AK-47 rifles turned up and they killed 13 people right where we're going. Now this house is still burning. This was attacked only a few hours ago.
Standing among the ruins of his home was this grieving farmer.
This poor man lost his mother-in-law, who was slaughtered there, and a couple of other female relatives. One of them was killed right here. The blood is still drying. And this is where she was slaughtered, right outside her house. And inside, one of his children was burned to death.
Josephine described the horrific raid in which half her family was butchered.
Josephine here says that five people have been sent down to hospital after creating mayhem all around here, and she puts the death toll at closer to 15. She says that the attackers went back to the forest.
These widows and orphans had watched their relatives murdered with their own eyes. You could see the trauma of war in the kids' faces.
Walking through the ashes of these still smouldering houses, I've just come across a ghastly discovery. The bones and the skull of a small child who was burned here last night.
I wondered why this conflict seemed to be escalating, even after leaders had declared an end to their election feud. I heard massacre victims had been taken to doctors in the nearby town of Kitale.
I want to talk to the survivors to ask them why they were attacked.
In a ward overcrowded with the injured, we found Stephen recovering from gunshot wounds.
Right.
You see, we are treating him for...
I shot him in the back.
And, chest. The bullet went in through there, came out down there.
Right.
Breathing through the back.
He's breathing through the back. He's got a hole in his lungs.
Stephen told me what he saw in the attack.
It's a terrible story he's just told me. The raiders entered his home. Eventually they set light to his house with petrol. And then they broke the door down with a stone. They came in shooting. They wounded him. They chopped up his wife, who's still surviving. And they killed three children.
He said the violence had reached a new level of brutality.
Stephen says that they are criminals who have taken advantage of the situation to commit crimes. And he's saying that the village has been subjected to killing since last year.
The Mount Elgon crisis started long before the elections. Over 500 have been killed here, tens of thousands displaced. Local people say little has been done to stop the massacres.
Dear idea. So what happened to these children?
Now, these children are burnt in a house.
During the attack?
Yeah, it's just a scenario almost similar to what the man they were describing.
Are they going to survive now?
Yeah, they're okay.
They're going to be okay?
Yeah, they'll be okay.
Well done. This little girl is called Miriam, and she's 10 years old, and her mother was slaughtered. They were decapitated, in fact. And this little girl is called Emma. She's 12 years old. She lost her mother, who was murdered together with two siblings. And so they've lost their mothers, they're orphans. The doctors are working overtime to save people's lives, but even on a normal day, the facilities are overstretched. And as a result, these two badly wounded little girls with very, very bad burns from the burning huts have to share a bed. What seems to be very evident is how bitter the attackers were. Have you ever seen anything like this before in the hospital?
Only during the post-election violence, when it was clear it was one tribe going at another, you know, that was interesting. But now this, I really don't know.
We were becoming aware that this conflict was spinning out of control. With so many victims, state institutions like this hospital seem unable to cope. In the town of Eldoret, we found camps brimming with refugees still too scared to go home.
Lines and lines of white tents provided by the Kenyan Red Cross, and people have got their little stoves outside their tents.
This is Jesse, once a successful businessman, now reduced to living in a cattle barn. He said his community, the Kikuyu people, had been ethnically cleansed by vast mobs of the rival Kalenjin group.
This time, they have brought that maybe a mighty power or a mighty force.
When you say a mighty force, do you mean hundreds of young men who are armed?
Exactly, the young generation. That is from 18 years, from 14 years to 34 years.
And those people weren't there before?
They were, maybe, they were small by then. But this time they have come up.
So the population has increased?
Exactly.
And that is the mighty force trying to drive you out?
Exactly.
How long has your family been here in the Rift Valley?
In the Rift Valley?
Yeah.
I was born and raised up here. My mom was raised up here too. She was born here. So this is where we know.
I visited Jesse's mum in her tent. The family has lost everything. They want to be resettled somewhere safe, but there's no land to accommodate them, and they have no idea how long they will be left homeless.
These are her clothes, her Bible, her kitchen utensils, and this is something supplied by the UN Refugee Agency. She's become a refugee in her own country.
Elsewhere, Kikuyu mobs had attacked Kalenjin. The wounds from the violence were still very fresh.